Hey folks, welcome to Real Thursdays. This is Michael Phillips, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. I am here with my colleague Nina Metz. Hello.
Hello.
And we're also here with Ben Sachs, one of the film critics for the Chicago Reader. Ben, thanks for coming.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Okay, so we are going to talk about the state of comedy. Not the whole thing, because that's kind of a longer than 10-15 minute segment.
Right.
But the new comedy this week opening is The Incredible Burt Wonderstone with Steve Carell, Steve Buscemi, and Jim Carrey. And you have a film that is probably, you know, we might as well just talk about the business end of it first. It's probably going to, quote, win the weekend, right? Steve Carell's got a sizable enough audience from things like The Office on television, and also, you know, his big breakout role after many other film roles was 40-Year-Old Virgin,
right,
which really proved that he could, quote, anchor a big, you know, comedy and get an audience larger than he'd known before. My question, having seen Burt Wonderstone, and Ben, I know you've seen it because I saw you there, I think in the no laughing section. Were you in the no laughing section for Burt Wonderstone?
I mean, during the times I was awake, yeah.
Okay, so it's either stony silence or napping. That's a. But some people like it, some people don't. I have to say, there was something about this particular comedy, and all you want from something like Burt Wonderstone, it seems to me, is a handful of good, stupid laughs from people who can reliably deliver. But what you don't want to see, and what I'd like to know how you felt about this, Ben, is you don't want to see good performers forced to bail out and redeem and somehow transcend material that, to me, didn't feel like it got past the first draft stage, despite all the rewrites and all the writing teams. I mean, how did it strike you?
Well, honestly, I don't really remember it. I mean, we saw it on Monday night, and I mean, I've had the really good fortune to have seen a lot of great movies for work lately. I've seen, you know, Alan Rene's new film is the last one. I've seen the new Ulrich Seidel film, the new Taviani Brothers film, you know, films with, you know, images that are meant to last for years or decades. And this one just, you know, kind of drifted right through.
Right through.
I think there's something okay about semi-disposable
Well,
comedy,
yeah, I mean,
right?
like Pauline Kael wrote in that piece of hers on Something Wild, she said something like, isn't it disposable pop culture that keeps us sane, or something like that?
Right.
And so, yeah, I mean, like, certainly there's got to be this base level of entertainment out there. But
Did you guys not like what I read about it, because I haven't seen it? But, like, if you compare it to something like Anchorman, where it's just sort of these excuses for jokes and bits, versus this seems to have a very specific plot to it. Did the plot gum up the works too much, do you think?
Well, I haven't seen Anchorman.
Okay. But, yeah. So for me, Anchorman, for those who haven't seen it, I mean, to me, that's like a reminder of how durable some of these stupid disposable comedies can be if you have not just the right people, but I guess just sort of the right spirit in terms of like coming up with a plot just enough to hold this stuff together.
Well, I mean, it's not like a de-evolution of American film comedy. I mean, there have always been these vehicles, these kind of disposable vehicles for performers that people like. I mean, this goes back to the silent age, and I mean, these movies turn up on cable TV late at night. I mean, Red Skelton was in movies like this in the 40s.
Sure, Abbott and Costello,
yeah,
all the great comedy teams, you know, made two-thirds of what they made was junk, essentially.
I don't know if it was
inferior,
junk.
Inferior.
Like, they were like, you know, time fillers.
Yeah.
And if audiences like their personas, you know, they would enjoy just spending another hour and a half with them.
Right.
Right.
So I guess in the case of something like this, it comes down to whether people enjoy spending time with Steve Carell and Jim Carrey.
You know, the other thing about it,
I wonder. They do, but the film is not good. That's the problem.
But I mean, isn't that kind of secondary? I mean, most.
It's secondary to the box office.
Like most American movies aren't good.
Yeah, I mean, the percentage is right. Right. I mean, I always, when people say, oh, you know, you're too hard on films, this and that, you know, I just say it's not that different from baseball. You don't hit more than 1 for 3.
It's hard
just
to make
don't.
Good art.
You cannot, yeah. And it's hard to make decent entertainment.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say this aspires to be art. So it's not even the kind of movie that, you know, I really feel compelled to get worked up about. You know, there are films that are offensively bad.
Yeah.
And this isn't. It's
lazy.
Really,
it's lazy.
Yeah, but it's inoffensive. I mean, I think, you know, it's. I mean, in this and the other Carell vehicles I've seen, You know, it seems like he's not trying to make fun of anyone. You know, there, it doesn't feel like there are characters or, you know, types of people who are being singled out as the butts of jokes. So
he generally plays much more naturalistic characters. This is like an over-the-top kind of a guy. So it's much more in that Jim Carrey kind
it's
of
a little
formula.
Well, it's a little different for him.
Here's my sort of question. It's basically mocking this whole sort of like situation in Las Vegas, these Siegfried and Roy type of entertainers, David Blaine type of entertainers.
David Copperfield is in the film.
And so I wonder, like, these are kind of over-the-top, cheesy acts to begin with.
Right.
So how much room is there to then parody that after that?
Right. Well, it's a good question. We should throw to a clip just so people have some sense of what we're talking about. This is a scene where a stunt designed to get this bickering magic illusionist duo, Steve Carell and Steve Buscemi, back on track, just to get some attention on the strip. Here's one scene.
A nice view. It's a little smaller than I thought it would be.
Okay, maybe if you'd come to even one rehearsal?
Maybe you need to rehearse sitting in a box, Anton. I don't.
Fine.
Not this guy. I can't breathe, I can't breathe!
Yes, you can!
No, so small! Hurry, it's so small!
Relax, it's only been 20 minutes!
All right, I got like five things wrong with that. I mean, it's Don Scardino, the director, has worked a lot in, he's done scads of series television as a director. He's mainly, started out as an actor. He has directed a lot of 30 Rocks, and you have Steve Carell, who certainly sustained a very dry performance on The Office for season after season. And you have these talents working in this sort of big, overblown slapstick vein, and this is what the script calls for, and there's no facility for it at all. I mean, we saw that film the other night, whatever you think of it, with a crowd of 300 people, and the laughter was, it was the peals of silence were deafening.
Well, here's what's interesting, because one of the screenwriters is a guy named John Francis Daly, who is an actor on the show Bones. He also got his start, though, acting on a show called Freaks and Geeks, which is a Judd Apatow TV series.
A good
that
show.
Launched Jason Segel, Seth Rogen, James Franco, Busy Phillips. So, like, he comes from a sort of good pedigree, that Judd Apatow pedigree, but it looks like the scripts that he's writing himself, he also did Horrible Bosses, sort of veer in a slightly more sour direction.
Sour, for sure. And I actually kind of liked Horrible Bosses was actually, it was crude and mean-spirited, but it just had better comic wiles. It had a structure. I actually was a little offended by this, actually, Ben. I don't know
in what way.
I guess when every joke in Burt Wonderstone is based on kind of a lazy sort of one-upsmanship and pain and humiliation. I mean, the Jim Carrey's whole thing is just about how badly he can injure himself as a gorilla street musician, magician, and it's. The audience just sort of gets in this defensive crouch for his scenes, was my reading of it. Just because it's all so kind of based on seared flesh and, you know, whatever, like a shot to the nads or whatever it is. And that's not for me. That's not
no,
the kind of slapstick
I think you're giving
like.
The movie a bit too much credit. I mean, when something's that, you know, flaccidly performed, it's, I don't know. I don't think it has the sharpness to really puncture.
Right.
I understand that sentiment, though. If you're watching something and it's just so sort of, like, I think people do have that feeling of you get angry when something's actively sort of bad or not working.
Not working.
How does it compare to Movie 43? Or what was that?
I didn't see that. I actually didn't see the anthology.
I had to see that for work.
Yeah,
and?
The anthology thing?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That was the Farrelly brothers, right?
I think they had some involvement with it. I mean, I don't really remember that one either.
this is the state of screen comedy in 2013, but
I don't know. I mean, like, comedy is difficult, and it's really subjective. You know, it's and again, when I don't take to something and it doesn't, you know, offend me morally, I don't really feel the need to go out of my way to put it down because there's going to be someone out there who laughs at it.
So you think it has good intentions to make us lazy?
Well,
I don't know.
I mean, I think its intention is to make money and appeal to the fans of these stars. There are movies like this that come out every week.
Yeah, every week. And I guess with this cast, you just feel like these people are good enough to know better, to settle for more.
Phillips, get over it.
But actually, what you're saying essentially is go and make your own movie, and this is what, in fact, has happened with something. I know nothing about Veronica Mars, the TV show, so I'm way over my head already.
You want me to describe
please
it a
go
bit?
Ahead. But we have a $2 million Kickstarter campaign for a canceled TV show. And set it up for us.
So Veronica Mars aired on the WB, the old WB, which doesn't exist anymore, aired from 04 to 07. And the whole premise of it, Kristen Bell starred as a high school student. It was sort of a noir set in a high school, modern day high school. I've never seen the show, but it's one of those shows that had like cult status. People loved this show. And everyone I've sort of read talk about it, that didn't make sense. But anyway, anyone who sort of talked about it has said, like, this is a great show. So it already had this built-in fan base.
So bring it back.
Okay, so the creator, Rob Thomas, wanted to make a movie. Warner Brothers owns the TV show, and Warner Brothers said, nah, we don't see sort of the money-making potential. So they were able to convince Warner Brothers to let them set up a Kickstarter account, which launched yesterday morning. Their goal was to raise $2 million, which is a lot on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
And by the way, what's interesting when you watch the video that accompanies it, Kristen Bell right now is very, very pregnant, and in the video she is not. So clearly they shot this months ago, and sort of the thinking might be like lawyers have been vetting this for months, right? Because if we contribute to this movie, you know, and Warner Brothers gets all the profits, Warner Brothers still owns it. That's sort of a unique setup.
So this is what's happened in one day.
They raised more than $2 million.
Yeah.
So this movie's going to be made over the summer. But I don't know, I think there's something a little obnoxious about this.
Who's the writer who said the lottery is a tax on stupidity? I mean, we can start saying the same thing about Kickstarter now, right?
This just feels off to me. It feels.
I understand,
like,
because Kickstarter is supposed to be the realm of the independent filmmaker who doesn't have access to financing or to financiers to find some money for their film. You know, Warner Brothers is not in that situation at all.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, this is a way for people who, this isn't just some crass attempt at commercialization. These are like people who genuinely like the show, who are saying, "Yeah, I would watch this movie. I'll kick in however many dollars I want to kick in to watch it."
Would you do that? I mean, would you actually say, "Hey, there's a show I really loved that got canceled, and if I liked it enough, I know you're not a TV man, but here's my $10." To me, do you work that way? Would you? You know, you're a rabid TV watcher.
Yeah, I mean, my first instinct is to just think it's kind of disgusting because I feel like if you're sort of working in a realm where you do have access to potential producers or financiers, that's the route you should go.
Right.
I mean, indie filmmakers generally do not. They struggle so much to sort of get access to whatever money is out there. On the other hand, like I said, it's not like they're, you know, this is Transformers that's trying to raise money. This is
Warner Brothers saying, if you can show us the audience, then we'll make this movie.
Right.
That's basically.
And is there any like promise to the people who've donated money that once this is made, you can see it for free, or you get a tote bag, or something?
Do you know how it works?
It works. What are they going to get out of it?
It works like NPR's or WBEZ's annual fundraising event. So like if you donate at certain levels, you get different things. So I think maybe you do get like a free iTunes pass to it or so, you know, depending on what. So yeah, there are different incentives. I think there was like $10,000 for like a speaking role or, you know, an odd.
Wait, someone gave $10,000 to this?
Yeah.
So it's like win a date with Kristen Bell.
They raised more than $2 million in one day. So yeah, there were people giving tons of money.
It's too much. To me, that's blurring the line in a way that I think Warner Brothers, it's a bad precedent. I don't know.
If it really will be a precedent, because how many other projects could really do this? Because you have to have like an established fan base already, right? So it has to be something that was either a TV show or a film already. And do you know what I mean? You can't just sort of out of the blue be like, "Hey, we're going to make this movie."
Well, I mean, this isn't a new thing in terms of, you know, mainstream acts using crowdsourcing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how... Radiohead released in rainbows, and I think that's how they're putting out all their albums now before they make physical copies. You know, people can pay what they want to get them online, but the difference there is that the album's already finished, and there's a guarantee that you know you'll actually get something out of it.
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, I like the idea of crowdsourcing and Kickstarting. I just but and maybe if I see a movie as lame as The Incredible Burt Wonderstone, you do wish anything had kickstarted it into some better shape. I don't know. But for now, we'll leave it there, okay? Those two topics, that's enough for one day, I think. Real Thursdays. Ben Sachs, thank you for coming.
Oh, you're welcome.
Nina, always a pleasure.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll see you next Thursday.